Welcome. This is Francis Petit from Fordham University in the Gabelli School of Business, and it's March 31st, 2020. And we are, this is the first event of our International Business Week for the Gabelli School of Business. And we are delighted to, in our first event, to have Ali El-Mahdy, the CEO of Hassan Allam Technologies with us, who's going to talk about business strategy, his own career, and how COVID-19 is may potentially impact his industry. And we're delighted to have him here. And so, Mr. El-Mahdy, may I call you Ali during the interview?
Yes, absolutely, sir. Okay, thank you so much.
So Ali, just maybe you can let everyone know your affiliation with Fordham University.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Ali El-Mahdy. As Francis said, I am the CEO of a company called Hassan Allam Technologies, based in Cairo, Egypt, and operating in the Middle East and worldwide very soon. I am a construction engineer running an electromechanical and digital transformation company. I graduated from Cairo University in 1996, and I was fortunate enough to be one of Fordham students starting in 2016 and graduating from the executive MBA program in August 2017. That's basically, I'm a father and a husband, have three boys, and we live in Cairo, Egypt, but most of the time, as Francis know, I am on the plane when there was a lot of planes on the air.
So, and hopefully had a great experience in our executive MBA program. One of the things about Ali, I think he has the record of being the student who commuted the furthest distance. Once a month, he flew from Cairo to New York City. So hopefully you had a very great experience as a Gabelli student.
Absolutely. And not only a great experience, I claim it was life-changing experience on professional basis as well as personal basis. Fordham became for me more than a school for to get your MBA degree. It became my second home and a place where I feel I belong to on many different levels, either with the faculty or my colleagues and cohort members.
So I know you've obviously had an international career. You've lived in many countries, one being United Arab Emirates, and you do a lot of traveling. Can you maybe share with the group your journey that led you to become now CEO of Hassan Allam Technologies?
Sure. As I said, I graduated as a civil engineer. I specialized in construction and started my career as project controls engineer. I worked in Egypt for a couple of years, and then I started moving internationally. I worked in Afghanistan, in Iraq, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, and that's for some time. And then I came back to Cairo. I became general manager of a company that is specialized in automation, which is very different from civil engineering. Nevertheless, I became general manager of that company for around 9 years. And after I finished my MBA program in 2017, I started revisiting my personal development and career plan, and then start looking for other opportunities that matches my my growth, let's put it this way, growth targets. And it happened that I was offered this job as a CEO of Hassan Allam Technologies. This is almost 25 years of working in construction and consulting business, and it has been a very interesting experience for me, in the sense of I have never seen myself as one market person. It's more like my abilities were more challenged, and my satisfaction was far more achieved when I was working on global basis, multiple countries, multiple projects, and at the same time, different backgrounds.
Wonderful. You know, it's one, I think, learning takeaway. And what we'll do is we'll have a nice dialogue, and we'll also open it up for questions. and the students can submit their questions. If not, depends how many people we have, but they could certainly submit their questions in the chat. But sure. I guess one interesting takeaway. So you were educated as and trained as a civil engineer, right?
Yes.
And certainly you have a technical expertise, and then you kind of gained more responsibility, and the responsibility was in terms of leading units and so forth. And you were probably promoted, and not even knowing how good of a leader you would be, good of a manager, you would be promoted most likely on the basis of you being a very good engineer and a project manager, right? And you get into this leadership role.
I think it was a combination between two things. The first one is definitely the technical competency and understanding of the nature of the business technically. Nevertheless, I think I was also fortunate enough to be seen as a leader and a creative person that go beyond the technical competency and find solutions to business questions. And I think the nature of my job is initially for the first 5 years, where I was more involved in project controls, allowed me to interact faster and more effectively with the leadership of the companies that I worked for. So they saw a lot of added value in what you do more than just the technical competency. Technical competencies definitely will deliver the basic expectations from you in a certain job. But to accelerate your career, you have to go beyond those technical competencies and understand the reality of your business and what are the objectives of this, of that particular business, that particular project, that particular area. That contributed a lot in my career development.
Well, congratulations. You know, you...
Thank you.
And it sounds like you provided solutions and value add beyond your role, which management took note. And you went above and beyond your role. So that's wonderful news. And so you become now CEO of Hassan Allam Technologies. And maybe talk a little bit about your reporting structure. And obviously you have a kind of a growth strategy. And maybe you don't have to get in that much detail.
Sure.
Maybe talk in general what some of those strategies are.
Sure. Hassan Allam Technologies is an electromechanical contractor as well as digital transformation service provider in Egypt. And we are the second largest company in a group called Hassan Allam Group. Hassan Allam Group is an 85 years old company specializing in engineering and construction. Currently, we are the largest contractor in Egypt by size of work. And the company has its own holding company. It's a family business owned by the family since 1935. And I have my board of directors, which consists of the chairman, is second generation engineer, and two of the third generation family members, as well as two independent directors. The company, as I said, it's an electromechanical contractor. For some of you who would really may not be aware of what that, it's a construction company. We provide solutions, firefighting, HVAC, air conditioning, transportation, airports, district cooling plants. And in the digital transformation part, we provide also building management systems, automation systems, as well as enterprise management system, similar systems like SAP and Oracle. We provide that as well. So the company has three business units, mainly. The first one is traditional electromechanical works, mobility sector, retail, district cooling, airports. And then we have the what we call business solutions, that is ERP systems, SAP, Oracle, and Microsoft. And then the digital transformation business unit specialized into data centers, low current systems, and automation systems. The company was established 4 years ago, so it's very, very new company in this old group. And it that establishing this company was to respond to a market demand, growing market demand for digital transformation and smart systems that is going exponentially, expanding in the Middle East and Egypt. And it requires a lot of specialization and a lot of technical competency, as well as innovative management or managerial approaches. The company started with very moderate expectation, and then with the market responded very positively toward the company is expanding very significantly. We are doubling up every 6 months in terms of work. And this is the time when the owners, the shareholders decided this is the time to bring in expertise from outside, people with extensive experience to take the company into the second level of growth and manage that. Our growth strategy is really based on the vision that was always there. This is a new era where there is a huge demand on smart systems, smart buildings, efficient energy usage, and digital transformation. And the value add that we provide is basically competent system solutions, mostly on local talents, and export that. First of all, to cover the Egyptian market and the Middle East market, and then start exporting that overseas, providing that we have a lot of particular differentiators in the sense of our costs are more efficient, our staff are well trained, as well as our ability to move fast and agile into new demands. We think this market, and we still think so, even in the face of the current crisis, but we think this is the future of construction. This is where energy efficiency or efficiency in usage, our energy and our resources are going to be paramount in transforming the way the world is. And we are shifting away from a market where it depends a lot on traditional construction, real estate, and facilities that were not particularly efficient, into an efficient systems.
Wonderful. So obviously it sounds like you do have a strong international strategy, knowing that the market in Cairo in some ways is finite for you, right? So yep. In terms of yes. growth. And I remember you did visit our Lincoln Center campus a few months back, and you were looking at business opportunities all throughout the United States. And yes. So as a leader, obviously, you know, you do have, it sounds like your growth targets, hopefully they're reasonable and achievable, right? And you feel pretty confident in terms of, you know, it sounds like you have three major lines of business, right? And maybe some have more growth than, like, certainly the solutions, I gather, might be an area that has more potential, potentially, I'm sure. But maybe out of your three lines of business, in terms of which would you think, in terms of the strategy, were you looking for the most amount of growth?
I'm so sorry, I lost you for a second. Do you mind repeat the last?
Yeah, just in terms of your lines of business, which is the what are the lines of business where you feel has the most potential for growth?
Digital transformation, for sure, and that was already a major pillar of our growth strategy since I joined in the third quarter of 2019. And I think now it is proven to be even more important. There is a definite expectation that the world after the COVID-19 crisis is not going to be the same anymore on many, many different levels. And one of the outcomes that has proven essential is how digitally ready we are. Each company, each business, all over the world, pursuing digital transformation is now becoming a necessity rather than fancy efficiency increasing plans for the future. So I think this is the area where we think there will be a huge opportunity for growth globally and regionally as well.
Okay, wonderful. So obviously your strategies were put together, your growth strategies, your international global growth strategies were formulated. And like what they say, it's much easier to formulate strategy than to implement and to execute. Yep. Right?
Yes.
But it seems like your global strategies have been put together prior to this outbreak. And just as of today, internationally, right? Just looking at the world meter on COVID-19, right? There's over 800,000 cases.
Yeah.
There's close to 39,000 deaths worldwide. In the United States, we're looking at about 165,000 cases. And obviously there is a good response rate in terms of recovery. But obviously in New York, so there's been over 3,000 deaths in the United States, and 900 of those, plus 900, have been in the New York City area. So obviously this is, everyone in some ways, is every country is establishing their own strategies on how to effectively deal with this, but it is affecting business, and your growth strategies were put together prior to the virus. So my question is, how do you, and you don't have, not necessarily with your industry, with your company per se, but your industry, how is the virus going to impact, in your belief, your industry?
Well, you can look at it in me, the way we actually approached it over the last 15 days. We are dealing with the direct impact on the short term from the virus itself and the risk, the health risk, and our ability to mobilize resources, teams, and access to workplaces and things like that. And then there is the outcome on the overall global economy and how that will affect the availability of business opportunities and availability or ability to grow and find more business opportunities as the world is getting into what was, I think, officially announced yesterday by the IMF, a global recession and possibly a depression after that. So there are two folds. And the first one is addressing really how we are dealing first and most important with our people and then with our current clients, and how that any decision that we will take right now on the short term will affect our strategy regardless of the external factors, how we will deal with our people, with our projects and our current clients. And the second part is how to reposition ourselves to face the global economy, the macro factors, and where will be the new opportunities and how those opportunities will affect our growth factors. And both of them, they have a common area. And the common area is basically, where is our value? Where do we create value actually as a company? And how that is actually to be protected during this period. The second one is what is our differentiators and how can we leverage that and keep them intact. Three is how we set our priorities right in terms of what is more important for us to actually navigate through the current short-term targets and then be ready for the long-term new conditions, new norms, as we call them. And the third one is are there any other areas in our strategy that we need to readdress when there are more clear data? And this is the most challenging thing. What makes this crisis very, very difficult to manage and very difficult to steer through is there is a lot of uncertainties. And as you just mentioned, the numbers are growing exponentially right now. The initial estimates and governments, the way they looked at the coronavirus 2 months ago, were very different from what we see today. And I think it's going to be very different from what we'll see over the next 2 weeks. So there is a lot of uncertainties here. And what we're trying to do is to navigate through those uncertainties with trends, with finding out trends, how the world is being reshaped, and in the same time, be very, very careful of the decisions that are to be taken right now, not to affect our growth strategy later on. We know it's going to finish one day, or it might be 6 months, it might be 3 months, it might be 18 months until there is a vaccine. In all cases, there will be a time when we are back and we have to be on ready at that particular moment. So back to this is, again, we are revisiting all our strategy elements. The core of them are our value and our value creation and our differentiations. And we're trying to keep this intact. At the same time, we are addressing everything else that might not sound as core or may not be the main elements. And we are getting rid of this. We are not addressing them now. We are addressing our core elements or core strategy elements. And keeping them intact.
So obviously looking at your value proposition and your value add, you know, this could actually lead to a new line of business or a new opportunity for your organization.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for bringing this up. But we think so. We believe so. And we think, again, at this point in middle of all of this uncertainties, but there are certain trends that we can see. People will be far more... they will be faster. They will be more eager to have digital transformation in place. They have more, I would say, policies in terms of design and implementation of works. There will be opportunities for companies like us, which create value through the intellectual property, their ability to integrate systems in an efficient and reliable way.
Do you think, obviously just looking at the numbers this morning, obviously, in Egypt, total cases in about 656. So it's kind of in the, you know, not in the beginning stage, but obviously, do you feel in Egypt this is it'll increase, the number of cases will increase?
That's a very difficult question. Well, we are now officially, I think, on the fourth week. We are in the sixth week since the first case was identified in Egypt. And so far, the numbers look reasonable. However, it all depends on how many tests are done every day in the country and how many people went into this process and they found negative or positive. There are a lot of uncertainties there. Taking into consideration the virus nature and that there might be other people outside there who don't have the symptoms and therefore they didn't need to go and take the test. So there are a lot of uncertainties there. However, the way we monitor it with the World Health Organization, the government, as well as our internal network in the group, it seems those are representing number. It seems it's all right for the time being. There is the line at 1,000 case, which even the government said when we reach the 1,000 case, it's very difficult to start tracing who was contacted by those cases, and then the numbers might go very high. So the possibilities are still there. We are not out of the woods yet. I think the next 2 weeks will be very, very determining in this situation.
Now, one thing is like in the news, you see, for example, yesterday in yesterday's news in New York, in Staten Island, the Amazon fulfillment center, there's been lots of protests by employees feeling that Amazon isn't providing them a safe environment. And also in Instacart, there was a news piece yesterday. You know, again, employees don't feel safe. And obviously that's negative PR. But then you go on the other side and you look to see, or, you know, you see just going on different websites, or AT&T, their response, more mobile hotspots. Apple is matching employee gifts to COVID-19 relief. General Motors is beginning to hopefully manufacture soon surgical masks and ventilators. Even New Balance, the athletic apparel, is looking to make facial masks. And even our partners, our academic and partners in China, different schools, they're contacting me because they want to send to Fordham, you know, supplies, masks, gloves, et cetera. So you see the kind of the negative PR and you see this positive PR. So I'm just wondering, do you guys in Hassan Allam Technologies, is there a PR strategy in terms of the company's position on the virus?
Yes. Well, and I think it's not only a PR strategy, it's a major part of our plan of how to tackle this. The first one is absolute transparency. And that means sharing with our team, all of them, the real situation, where we are, how can we survive this crisis, how long we can manage to get the people working with half of the capacity, working from home. All of the necessary actions that are taken are shared in transparency with our team and our partners as well, because we have also a huge network of supply chain network, including subcontractors, suppliers, and partners. So the first part is transparency, absolute transparency in this situation. The second part is trying to serve not only the staff and the partners, but more into the community in that sense. And we have taken, and we are actually implementing some major initiatives now. We are coordinating them with various official entities to provide the services in that line, providing equipment and PPE particularly, as well as even taking far bigger initiative that might come out within the next week or so to help or support basically the community and the government to be ready if the number of cases increase. So this is number one. Number two, there is a major understanding that in crises like this and with the new communication platforms that are all over the world, you will always have certain reactions that are not necessarily positive because you cannot do something that is perfect at this time. Mm-hmm. And we are addressing all the issues that come up. However, there is this conviction that there will always be a certain negative aspect of this crisis. As you said, if some people in Amazon are working at this point and they are having a lot of issues with regard to the supply of protection and the number of working hours or whatever, but at the same time, you see on the other aspect that there are 3.5 million new claims of unemployment in the US over the last week. So there is that thin balance. And as companies, as leadership, we have to understand that not all the people are equipped to face this fear, which is more dangerous than the virus itself, of their work, of their income, of their families, and all of that. There is fear. And when it comes to fear, you don't expect rational or reasonable reactions. You have to be patient enough. This is the responsibility of the companies and the leadership to be more patient. The workforce are driven by basic needs at this point. So there has to be a lot of patience and a lot of understanding.
Wonderful. Thank you. It's a balance for any leader that you have.
Yes. Yeah.
So I guess, you know, my last question, then we could open up to questions with the group. And I we want to be sensitive to the curfew in Cairo.
Thank you. So thank you.
That. But I guess my last question before we open up to the group is, if you were a strategy management consultant for McKinsey, right? And you're working with corporations as a consultant on strategy, what would your advice be, regardless of the industry, to these organizations?
I think the main point here is goes back to the value proposition and the value creation. Identify your core differentiators, what that you do and you cannot lose, you cannot afford to lose, regardless what happened, because this is where you will start after the crisis is over. Second part is going to be you as a company that invested a lot in its systems and people and clients' relationship, work very hard, communicate continuously to maintain these networks. The difference in this crisis versus any other crisis is it caught the world off guard. And therefore, the possibility that once this is over, the world economy will come back faster than it did in 2008 or before that. So companies should not rush into cost-cutting measures and panic mood measures. It's more about don't act as if this is going to be continuous forever, but in the same time, be conscious that you cannot afford to have extra fat or things that are away from your core for long. But nevertheless, keep your people, or keep your core people, your core value, your network intact. Communicate, support, and reach out even for help if you need to.
Wonderful. You know, it's great that you have more of a long-term perspective. And I think what's plaguing most organizations and most industries is the short-term perspective and the short-term thinking. And, you know, obviously there's going to be a response, an immediate response, right? And you'll because I think this short-term kind of, every 90 days, you know, if you have to report your earnings every 90 days, there's, you know, you have that's in the back of all these leaders' minds. So
I have one comment on this. I don't know, but we had a discussion, you and I, if you recall, a couple of months ago. And I think we as a Hassan Allam group, we are fortunate that our ownership structure is still a family-based company. And therefore, there is a lot of, different way of dealing with things in terms of keeping the long-term vision, knowing that this is a crisis that will pass. Public companies are far more difficult to manage in that sense, because as you said, it's short-term, you have the quarterly reporting, it might be a little bit difficult for them to try to sustain long-term vision while they have the pressing need to release their financials and earnings every 3 months.
Yes, yes. So thank you. Thanks for your comments. No, I gave you all the questions, right? And I can ask you more questions, but I want to open it up to the group to see if the group has any questions for you.
Sure.
You can either talk or submit them. And I know we have. Are there any questions for the group for CEO Ali El-Mahdy? It's quiet.
It is. Come on, guys.
So you said that this is an event-driven kind of stagnation or depreciation on the economy. When you are looking, at least for, let's just say, from a trader's perspective or from a stockbroker's perspective, how would you consider that job market to fare compared to other job markets?
I'm sorry, the line cracked up. I didn't get the question. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So you said that this would be like an event-driven kind of depreciation on the economy, and that the economy would bounce back quicker than it did in 2008. When you look at a job market like financial services, how would you compare that and possibly the short-term future for that, the next 3 to 6 months, compared to other job markets?
I see. Well, I'm not an expert in the financial markets, but what I can say about this is this drives us back to looking at companies and stocks out there, and you have to look back to the fundamentals and what these companies are producing and what they are doing. And is it a market sensitive products and services, or it's more like long-term services and so and product. For instance, I see a lot of reactions in the financial markets towards companies that have been performing very well over the last years, and all of that, airlines and shippers and things like that. And I find the reaction toward them a little bit strange for me. I'm not the expert, but I find that the reaction is more like people fleeing companies without really looking into those companies. It's more about the movement of the shares prices rather than looking at the radical or the fundamental part of those companies. That's in terms of the market itself. In terms of the financial sector, there is that, as Francis just said, there is that culture of we have 3 months, 6 months reporting, and we have to match these, and we have to do things right now to show better reports. Mm-hmm. While I think the bigger question is, what will you do when the crisis is over? I think this is the bigger, the more important forecast for everyone. We know that the first quarter went very bad, right? And we know most probably the second quarter is going to be the same. And the recovery will be toward the third and fourth, possibly the fourth quarter by the end of the year. So the question I think everyone should ask in general, what is the plan in December 2020? I think this is the more important question. I think this is a more important evaluation than just the performance. No one can judge a performance by end of March or by end of June, per se.
Mm-hmm. The average lifespan of a CEO in a public company is 5 years or so, 5 years. And obviously they're judged by these quarterly reports. So I guess it's, but it has to be top down, and it has to be from the corporate boards. You know, how accommodating will they be during the crisis? And hopefully that could be, you know, if they're accommodating, that could be cascaded throughout the organization and realize this is just a variation. This is just a slight variation in the trajectory, right?
Yes.
So that's at least my thoughts there.
Yeah.
Thank you. Is there any, are there another question out there for Ali?
I think there is one.
Yes. So what regions, areas of the U.S. offer the most potential for your company and why? This is from James.
Hi, James. That's a very good, that's a great question. I think the south part, the Gulf area in the U.S., Texas, Louisiana, are the way we see it right now, are our highest potential in the U.S. There is many projects in oil and gas, particularly in oil and gas, that we believe that we have very good opportunity to provide services there.
And that's where your travels when you visited Gabelli a few months back, that's where you were.
Right? Yeah, I was in Houston, Texas. Yes.
But interestingly, Louisiana has been impacted by the virus. Per capita. So that'll have an effect. Any other questions for Ali? So how's your maybe you want to talk a little bit about your, you know, obviously work-life balance now, especially with this. So you're a husband, you're a father. Why don't you share with the group?
Thank you. That was, I think I did not share that with you before, but I think one of the greatest things that I have learned during my MBA program in Fordham is really to look into the life balance and the personal life as not only a reason of happiness as we all approach it and all of that, but as an integral part of our ability and our triggers for growth. And it really made a difference in how I manage my personal life to a great extent. Having to work all over overseas and traveling a lot, I did not have enough time to spend with the family and to be a part of their, you know, daily and weekly and monthly activities, be close to them. And so it was for me another project that I had to actually plan and work on very hard. And I used a lot of tools that I got from the MBA program to be able to do that. And I'm very happy to say that it really works. The time is always a challenge. But when you think of your personal life as something that you have to take care of, and it's not something that comes out by coincidence, you need to plan it, you need to be active, and you need to put a lot of effort there in an organized way, it pays back. And I think that was, over the last 2 years, I think it made a huge difference for me. How to balance life, how to be a part of the boy's life, how to be a husband that is participating and sharing, even if you don't have enough time, like a typical 9-to-5 job, but you're still doing the effort. And families have that tendency. If they see you doing the effort, they will respond to it.
Wonderful. And I just really quickly, you're on the road. So like how many weeks per year are you traveling and you're away from your family?
Last year, I think overall, 15 to 20 weeks away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we have another question. As the CEO of a relatively young company within a longstanding firm, how do you honor the culture and traditions of the company while remaining nimble and creative? So
I love this question. Oh my God, this is a great question. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. This is actually, I think this is a very, very interesting question. It's not easy. And I spend around 8 weeks negotiating and thinking about joining the group. And one of the first things that always came to my mind, how I'm going to fit into the culture of 85 years, 3 generations. And it was so, it's always very evident once you go into this company, how do you see the culture? You can feel it. So that was the first question. The second question is, okay, I'm going to run or manage the company that is like the newest one of them. And by far the most different company, because we are looking at digital transformation, smart systems and all of that, while the company is a construction group that comes with huge heritage in civil and heavy civil works. I think, I have to give the credit to the second and the third generation of the shareholders. They are extremely open people, well-educated, very understanding of those factors. And that gave me a lot of comfort back then and still is doing that. The second part is, it's a lot of effort, but you have to do it as a CEO. When you come in, you cannot just try to show yourself, oh, I'm new CEO and this is what I want to impose. You have to really, really to understand the culture. You have to adapt to it. And you have to respect that it has flown this group and make it grow for 85 years. And it's not, there are many, many leaders who go, who would go into a new company or in a group that is existing there and was like, okay, this is my style and I want to impose my style because I believe it is right. Yes, they might be right, but you cannot disrespect that culture. You have to take it in. Especially that it definitely contains a lot of good things, great things. Otherwise, it wouldn't have survived for 85 years. So I was very, very conscious about how to dissect this culture, how to actually measure it, how to measure my actions, my decisions, my planning, and even my communication against those attributes, cultural attributes, I would say.
So did you, obviously, I think one of the downsides in corporate life is that is the lack of innovative mindset in an organization, just because of the financial pressures. And most organizations, whether it's new product development or whatever, tend to have a more conservative strategy because they don't want to fail. And obviously, you have strong international growth goals, and now you have this new hurdle with the virus. But as a CEO, it has to come top down. So maybe we'd like to share, you know, your way you go about that, because there's a lot of creativity from within, right? There's people in your organization that can add that kind of value.
I think this is it's a little bit easier for us in the construction industry because we are project-based companies. So we are not very driven by the quarterly culture or by the financial results only, but more.
Hello.
What is that? I'm sorry.
We lost you for a second.
Yeah. So construction in industry in that sense is more agile toward those changes. And the fact that we work in by project or project based gives us the ability to look at the end of the project rather than the financials driven decisions. This is number one. Number two, to deliver projects, and there is a statistic that says that only maybe 30% of the projects will be per plan. So you have almost 70% of your projects are not going per plan. So there has to be a lot of creativity on how to get the projects back and achieve the targets. So there is a part of this culture that actually has made sound very old and have a lot of heritage and maybe against creativity, but actually it contains creativity inside. And if the decisions or the plans or the creative approaches will create value toward the end of the implementation, they are more open for risks than any other industry in that sense.
Okay, great. So let's see if we get one more question. Is there one final question before Ali closes out for the group?
If that's okay. Thank you for your presentation. My question is very simple. I just wonder how far back, since your work is project-based, how far back have you had to move your work in this COVID-19 phase? Thank you.
I think the key question, we stopped work, let's say now for 10 days, we totally shut down all our projects. Because we had to take safety and health and safety precautions, disinfection and all of that. And we send the people back home and we are paying them. The problem is each week we lose in a project is not recoverable by 1 week. Usually it takes 1.5 weeks to 2 weeks, 2 weeks in time to be able to recover 1 week. So at this point, I think we are facing a major setback until today. I'm very careful about that. Until today, I think we lost maybe around a month's time in 3 months. So there are also other factors that that really affected us other than the shutdown and the lockdown. The supply chain network again is a very major had a very major disruption over the last 3 months. Equipment from China, from Europe, from the US. We're affected. We are expecting them instead of expecting them in April. Now we don't even know if we'll get them in July or August. So it's not really like a shutdown period. There is, it's not really a snowball, but a lot of uncertainties when it comes to time at this period. But the clients are understanding. Thanks God for that so far. Thank you.
That was great. I know we want to be sensitive to your curfew. Right.
So thank you.
You have to commute home and be home by 7 p.m. Cairo time. But this was absolutely wonderful, Ali.
Thank you.
Do you have any just closing thoughts, any closing recommendations you want to give the students and the Gabelli community, just from your perspective?
Thank you. I think this crisis right now gives us all a chance to slow down a little bit and look at what is important for us on professional basis, on personal basis, and makes us reevaluate the priorities in that sense. And I think one of the lessons that I will never forget coming out of Gabelli school team or our student is you have to do what you think is good for yourself, what you love as work, not what makes more money. Money will come eventually. Position will come eventually. It's really about the passion of what you do. And when you have the passion to do, when you are doing what you have passion for, it doesn't matter what kind of hurdle, crisis, you are in your normal environment. And it's amazing how you see people that you can immediately tell in the middle of the crisis who is more comfortable, more calm, more composed in doing the most difficult thing in the world, while others that are extremely disturbed by the smallest thing, by the smallest piece of news. And I'm talking about everyone from top down. So going back as a final conclusion in this, and especially for students that are still to make decisions in their life and their career, really, really take the time, look what do you think is the work and the activities that you have a lot of passion for and that you love. Everything else will come after. Thank you.
Oh, wonderful. You know, just on behalf of the Gabelli School of Business, I'm very grateful, Ali, for your time and for sharing your experiences. And we're very proud of you being a graduate of our school.
Thank you, sir.
And personally, I very much value our friendship. So
thank you, sir. Same here.
And I just want to wish you safety, and plus all the students at Fordham, because no one's in the dormitories. Everyone's away. We had over 70 students listen to your words of wisdom, which is great. And at this point, I'm supposed to give you a gift, right? We're going to mail you a gift at the right time for your team.
Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate it. I already, I wouldn't say that out loud, but I think I always, I'm fortunate and I'm blessed to be able to be one of Fordham graduates. Thank you so much. And thank you for everyone who had the time to come and join us here. And I hope I was helpful, maybe useful for some of you. And I really appreciate the time. Thank you so much. And guys, be safe and stay healthy.
So yes, I'm wishing you and your family safe health and everyone safe health, and be cautious, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
We'll close it out now. But once again, thank you, Ali. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ali.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.